Welcome back to Collider Jedi Council. I'm Kristian, and that's the microphone right next to me. That is the Smith Lord, Tiffany Smith.
This is my microphone.
Right next to her, it's Obi-John Kenobi, John Campea.
Good to be here, guys.
And sitting next to him, making his return, not this long of a return this time, it's Rocha Fett, Mr. John Rocha, the Outlaw's here.
How's it going, everybody? I got my dancing Boba Fett shirt on, so I'm ready to go. Let's have this happen.
Let's do it. Millennium Falcon just blocked that poor problem. Okay, so this is the Star Wars show, guys. As you know, we talk about the Star Wars here, and there's a lot of stuff to talk about. First, the way we do it, we talk about Star Wars movie news. That's everything happening in the cinematic ventures of Star Wars. You're going to have episodes 7, 8, 9, Han Solo movies, the possible Boba Fett movie. That'll happen. And a couple other things, but Rocha Fett will be reading these stories today. What do you got, John?
Yeah, I'll do my best, Mark Ellis. Well, the first story we're going to start off with, we talked about this last week, the idea of Disney possibly recreating Carrie Fisher in a CGI way, and it's coming out now. The Guardian initially reported that Disney denied that they were in negotiation with Carrie Fisher's estate to possibly do this, and apparently that wasn't enough to quell the rumors. Now we have an update from the Star Wars website, and their statement is, "We don't normally respond to fan or press speculation, but there is a rumor circulating that we would like to address. We want to assure our fans that Lucasfilm has no plans to digitally recreate Carrie Fisher's performance as Princess or General Leia Organa. Carrie Fisher was, is, and always will be a part of the Lucasfilm family. She was our princess, our general, and more importantly, our friend. We are still hurting from her loss. We cherish her memory and legacy as Princess Leia, and we will always strive to honor everything she gave to Star Wars." So, Kristian,
yes, sir.
Do you think this puts to bed the rumors of a CGI Leia, bless you, or is this just a savvy PR move for now so that this dies down and they can revisit it later as an option when the technology catches up?
You can't do that. I understand it's a very valuable question, but there's... No, you can't do this. As Lucas, when they come out and they say, it will not happen, it will not happen. Mm-hmm. You can't do that because people will be like, oh, wait a minute. You said you weren't going to do it. How dare you guys do it? You say you were going to, you're lying to us. And they will be. This will be a lie.
Okay.
If they go and do it. So yeah. I think that it's a move they wanted to put to rest. We talked about this on Movie Talk this week, and I'll just kind of repeat some of the stuff that I said there. And it's just, look, this is something... It's one thing when it's, oh, so-and-so, Snoke might be Darth Plagueis. They don't have to respond. John made the point on Movie Talk that they actually like when we talk about this stuff,
yep.
the speculation. That's great. That just gets us talking about their story. This is different. This is something where it's the morality of the company's being put into question. So they're also, you know, whether it's you would say it should be CGI or not, they want to let you know. Not that that would have, I said it last week. There could have been a scenario that they did it and they could have done it classy. So, but they wanted to go out and tell you definitively, we're not going to go this route. Mm-hmm. Now, the other part of the conversation is how they're going to do it in general with how the story, but that's not what we're talking about right now. It's a matter of, do we think that they handled it the right way? Should they have come out and said this? John, how do you think?
Well, look, first of all, you're absolutely right. If Lucasfilm wanted to still ponder the concept of doing her CGI, and by the way, one of the things we pointed out before, even if they wanted to, they couldn't. The technology is not yet at the point where you could do that realistically. And we understand and we know that their plans for Princess Leia or General Leia going into episode 9 was a very big part of episode 9. So there's no way they would consider trying to pull off a CGI character through anything more than is a scene with them basically standing still. I mean, because that's what you do with all the stuff so far that you have. So you don't do it. But if they wanted to consider it, they would just do what they do with all the other rumors. Stay quiet on it. They wouldn't make a comment on it. They would evaluate, decide what they want to do. Then once they decide what to do, maybe they say something. At this point, they've now painted themselves into a corner. And I believe on purpose. That, look, we don't plan on doing a CGI Carrie Fisher. So we're just going to tell you that right now. And the fact that they are coming out and addressing that rumor when they never come out and address rumors tells me that it is pretty definitive. For me as a fan, I still believe that, and they have the luxury that the fact that they hadn't started shooting episode 9 yet. So if they want to rework episode 9 to take the Princess Leia character out, that's fine, if that's what they want to do. But I am still completely fine with the idea of them recasting the character. We've seen them do that with Dumbledore. Granted, Dumbledore was a different scenario. We hadn't seen Dumbledore for four decades. I totally get that. But this notion, I still completely and utterly reject the notion that it's disrespectful to Carrie. You know what would have been disrespectful to Carrie Fisher? If she was still alive and weighed, you know, 180 pounds, perfectly reasonable, and Lucasfilm said to her, we want our Princess Leia to weigh 120, and she says, well, I'm not putting myself through that to weigh 120, and then Lucasfilm said, well, then we're recasting Princess
Leia. That would be unfair.
That would be disrespectful. Right. That would totally be disrespectful. But I reject the notion that now that Carrie Fisher has passed away, that continuing the character on, a character that she spent a better part of her life bringing to us, a character that she broke her back to bring Princess Leia back to us in Star Wars Episode 7. You look at all the stuff she put herself through to bring us the Princess Leia that both Lucasfilm and herself wanted to present on screen. If you think for one second that that it would be disrespectful, that Carrie Fisher wouldn't want the character continue on. If Carrie Fisher were here today, I feel very confident about this. And you said to her, it would be disrespectful of them to carry on Princess Leia without you here. She would go, ha! She would laugh at you. She would call you a ninny. I think the most respectful thing you can do for Carrie Fisher is to honor her legacy, get a top-rate talent to fill in to honor Carrie Fisher by carrying her character on. And if they do, great. If they don't, that's fine. I just reject this notion that it's somehow disrespectful to Carrie to carry this character on that she so lovingly brought us for so many years.
Just speak on that real quick, because Tiffany, I want to hear your thoughts on all of this. The one thing with recasting, I think, because I talked about this last week also, if you're going to... It's obviously, it's tricky. There are fans that are, it's going to be very hard.
Very sensitive.
It's not the Paul Walker situation to where Paul Walker, they were already shooting stuff. So they
and he had a brother that looked a lot like him.
Yeah, and they did, but they did.
They still digitally them up a little bit.
Enhanced. But here is what we don't know. We don't know what the story is. So if there is a scenario at the end of episode 8 that can wrap up her story, that you can give her a classy, proper send-off, the character of Leia, then they should try to do that. Mm. But if we see the end of episode 8 and there's still a lot of loose ends to tie up, that it would just be awkward if they got rid of the character or the character kind of went off or is in meetings or is, you know, or passes away or whatever it might be. It's a tougher scenario because we know of a potential arc with her son. Mm-hmm. We know of the potential arc of reuniting with her brother.
She's still the leader of the resistance.
Yeah. Right. Does this stuff happen in episode 8? Because if it does, like I said, there's ways to go around it. If it doesn't, it's going to be hard not to recast. So it's tricky all the way around. Tiffany, how do you feel?
I was actually surprised that they came out and said anything because I hadn't seen a lot of press or coverage from anybody being upset about the idea that they were even talking to them about it. So that was really surprising that they came out and made a definitive answer, because I think that when we talked about it last week, it was just saying that this is an option. They're not saying they're definitely doing it, but they wanted to make sure that the family was on board before if they move forward with coming up with how they are going to move forward with the next episode. I think that, like John was saying, it's, you know, there's so much stuff that has come out. And if you've read anything that Carrie Fisher has written or watched her do any interviews, she did not take herself so seriously. I think it's like the Steve Martin tweet came out and people were like, that's offensive to her. And I'm like, I think she would have laughed about it. I think in this situation too, it's, you know, she gave them the right to do a CGI younger version of her for the first film. So they already have some rights. I don't know what exactly that looks like. So I don't think that she would be opposed to it. I bet you she'd be like, yeah, can you make me look hotter?
That is something she would say.
Yeah, I feel like that is something she would do. And so jumping off of your point with the story, I would be, as you were just talking about, I'm like, I know we've talked about having some massive kind of funeral for Han Solo. If that doesn't happen in episode 8 and there is a way to possibly, I don't know if her story is a little bit wrapped up, we write a book in the middle that we get more detail about what happened, and the beginning of the next episode is we get a crawl and we have a funeral procession for Leia, that would be something that I think people would really get on board for. If that's not the case, as you said, if it's too difficult, I don't want to ruin the story so much that they're trying to wrap things up that aren't ready to be wrapped up. As far as recasting goes, it's so hard because my immediate thought is it's got to be someone that we don't recognize. It has to be somebody that's totally fresh and totally new. Otherwise, we're going to come in with baggage with this actress.
What if it was Meryl Streep?
It would feel so weird because it's Meryl Streep. I mean, I understand that it would be bringing in a great actress to honor what Carrie Fisher had done, but I don't know. I almost wish that it's someone with like a little bit more of a blank slate so we can see them and just see General Organa instead of seeing, oh, this person is playing Leia. Because when you do the younger version of Han, we've got a new actor. Hmm. You get it. It's easy to say this is a new actor playing Han, but it's not the same age. If someone were to come in and play Han Solo at the age that Harrison Ford is right now, I think that would be really difficult. So again, just going back to my point, I'm just surprised that they came out and said anything because I don't think they needed to.
Rocha?
I think it's interesting. It's an interesting conundrum because you're like, one side, they're reacting so quickly to this. They're trying to stop it so quickly. And we haven't even gotten over the grieving process yet. We haven't had to, like, there's still time. So this is an interesting thing that they came out and said. But I think you're right, John. They said it because they're just like, we got to say it because we'll be done with it. And then we're going to make the adjustments so you're prepared as an audience that we're not going to do this going forward. So you accept it. But I am not in a recasting. I don't want to have her. I'm one of those people that do not want to have a recast. When they did it in a small way for The Matrix, it bothered me because the Oracle was that woman in the first two films.
How do you
when
do
they
it
recast her from
though?
The girl from a different world, I just didn't. It just threw me off.
How do you do it story-wise though?
Yeah, that's what I mean. And I think what they're going. I think you do. I think you have the thing with Skywalker. I think that's going to happen in Episode 8. Mm-hmm. I don't think her confrontation with Kylo was good. I think that was going to happen in Episode 9. So now, and I think that's why they're meeting now to kind of how do we figure this out? How do we wrap her up, kill her off in some way, do it off screen, do it as explosion, do it as something that's the first line in Episode 9 in the crawl? Like, we don't know how we got to do this. So let's take a look at what we have in Episode 8 and how do we make it work so that she's accepted. But the CGI, I wouldn't have had a problem with it for the same reason that you guys defend the fact that she could be recast. I think Carrie wouldn't have had a problem with it at all. She was buried in a Prozac pill urn. That's her approach to life. Very fun, playful, jokey, not taking anything seriously. And I think she wouldn't have had a problem with the CGI. And the same thing, Tiffany. She said, make me look better, make me look more attractive. So that would have been, take these wrinkles out. You know, she'd have been like that. So for me personally, I don't have a issue with the CGI. And for them shutting it down, okay, I accept it. But if they're going to do it story-wise and make it work, I trust them to do it. They've done really good jobs on the reshoots in the first two films. So I don't have any problem
with that. The other thing I kind of think it puts out there is the fact that what they did with Tarkin is an exception. It's not the rule that they're moving forward with, which I think a lot of people saw that and were like, oh, they did it with Tarkin. They'll totally do it with Carrie. So I think it'll be interesting to see moving forward if they decide to do more CGI with any characters, let alone just what they're doing with Carrie.
I got to bring up one thing, though. Like, one of the questions that we don't seem to be talking about is, obviously and understandably and rightfully so, we're talking about making sure we maintain respect for Carrie Fisher. At some point in the conversation, though, we also have to have a conversation about respect for the character of Princess Leia.
True.
Right. Very true.
Princess Leia, who's been the central figure of this entire story, do we do an off-camera explosion and suddenly Princess Leia is gone? Like, is that respectful to the character that Carrie Fisher brought us? So I think I would be more uncomfortable with the idea of taking one of the best, strong female characters we have ever had, who is a template for those types of characters to come in Hollywood history, who has been the centerpiece of the big three for all the Star Wars saga up to this point, to then write her off in an off-scene explosion of something. You know, I feel very uncomfortable. Yeah.
That's going
to
be...
I'm not the one who has to make the decision. I do not envy Colin Trevorrow right now.
Colin Trevorrow, I mean, and the Lucasfilm is going to be tough.
Well, let's be honest. This isn't Colin Trevorrow's decision.
This is going to be Kathleen Kennedy's. He's the one who's going to get the one who has to execute. And he's going to carry the brunt of it if it goes badly.
He's the one who's
going to
get the blame if it goes badly.
And Ryan, too, because Ryan may have to adjust his film now from what he had originally thought he was going to do.
I don't think they're going to adjust that.
That's already in the can, though. I don't think they're going to change that.
You can't.
They readjusted Rogue. That's 60%.
But that was part of the plan. They planned those reshoots in advance.
They were reshooting. Okay. This movie's like, they're
done. That brings up a question, though. Do you think that there's a possibility that they say, we need to do something and change the ending and have something to wrap up to move into the next episode?
I think it is too damaging to do. And you're going to have to go back to reshoots. You're going to do all these different things in order to do it. There's no way that's going to happen. They want to get to that December. This is a touchy situation, we know.
Yeah.
But there's also Disney's also and Lucasfilm. They're also looking as far as their business model, what they have to do as far as getting this movie out. It's on their slate. It's coming out in December.
I think it's safe to say, despite how, you know, whatever feelings I express about it or all of us at the table, I think it's safe to say that this is one of those situations in life where there is no definitive right answer or definitive wrong answer to this. It's we're all going to have our individual feelings about it one way or the other. All we can do is like trust the people at Lucasfilm who we know they adored Carrie and we know they adore the Star Wars franchise and they know how much both of those things mean to us, that they will do the best they can. And hopefully it comes across in a good way, whichever way they decide to go.
Yeah. All right, what's next?
Cool. Keeping with the Carrie Fisher theme, E.T.'s Nichelle Turner interviewed Laura Dern at Elle's Women in Television event at the Chateau Marmont this past weekend. And Laura Dern said, "I don't know any of us who didn't play Princess Leia for a Halloween or in our life." She said she recalled watching the film when she was 6 years old in 1977 at the Cinerama Dome. What an incredible gift to witness that whole legacy. We put a lot of focus currently on what it is to be a female icon, what it is to use your voice, what it is to be comfortable in your own skin. She has always been one of the most extraordinary beacons, an original screen icon. She also talked about her work in Episode 8, said it was the time of her life. Obviously, she didn't reveal what her character does or any of the plot details. Christian, what do you think about what Laura had to say? Is she echoing what a lot of us feel about
Carrie? She's echoing what a lot of people are saying, absolutely. But I did think that, you know, hearing the stories about her as a little girl and dressing up as Leia and how much Leia had meant to her, but then being able to be on screen with her, because I think that Laura Dern is going to be playing, like, I think it was set up in Bloodline, the novel. Mm-hmm. I think that she's going to be one of these politicians that knew that Vader was Leia's dad and held it against her. Cool. And whenever, I think she's going to be one of the people that is against Leia, and I think that she's perfect for that type of role. So I thought they were classy comments, and
I think it was, you know, it was funny because in the little interview, she's like, "Can you tell us anything?" She's like, "I'm having the time of my life." So she's like, "So nope, you can't tell us anything," which I'm like, it's so true. That's all you can really say. And I almost expected her to say, "I'm in the Star Wars movie," and that's it. But it's true. When you hear people talk about Star Wars, it's really fun because you can see a change in everybody. Like we said when we talked to Diego Luna, or when she's doing the interview and she says, you know, I went to see these movies. I dressed up as Leia. And you can almost see like a twinkle in her eyes where it's just like, that's what Star Wars does to people. And being able to talk about a female character at an event like this for Elle, where it's just, like you were saying, John, this is such a strong female character within the cinematic universe of all films. So getting to be at that event and talk about Carrie in that way and Leia in that way, I'm sure was a pretty cool experience for her.
Yeah, I love it. I thought it was great, too. I think Laura's Dern, I love that she's coming back now into the fold in the movies and showing up again, because this woman is fantastic talent, and she's always good in everything she does in multiple genres, you know, from David Lynch to romantic comedies to she's great, to obviously Jurassic Park. So there's always these great. So it's nice that she's going to bring some gravitas to this. And if she does play a senator, I would love that, because she's perfect at playing those hard-edge characters. And so to me, I think this is fantastic, because she's echoing what a lot of girls during that time felt. Like, there weren't a lot of these roles. So you get Leia, then you get Sigourney Weaver and Alien. Like, you have these icons that come into it. And now a rebirth is happening again in 2016, 2015 of the female leads in these franchises. So
Sarah Connor.
Yes, right. Sarah Connor came along. That's right, 92. So all those things are happening. And I think she's just echoing what we all felt when we would do Solo or we would do Skywalker. Little girls were doing Leia, and there's a power in that. And so I think it's great.
Sure.
Wonderful comments, kind of reasserting what a lot of us have felt of what she has meant to us and what that character has meant, not just to fans of Star Wars, but fans of cinema and really the kind of the prototype of those types of female characters that I wish more Hollywood studios would get back to portraying.
Yeah. All right, what's next?
All right, this is a long one, so bear with me. I don't know if you know this, but Mark Hamill has a show called Mark Hamill's Pop Culture Quest. I don't know if John Campea knows this.
Very familiar with it.
On this week's episode, collector Brandon Allinger presented Luke Skywalker's lightsaber to Mark Hamill, and it was the actual prop used by Hamill in Return of the Jedi. What Allinger also revealed was it was the same prop that was used by Alec Guinness in A New Hope. So this means Luke Skywalker was holding what was in essence his master's lightsaber, albeit with some modifications, different color blade. Now, Star Wars fans have known for a long time that Luke's second lightsaber looked way more like Obi-Wan's than his first one did. And a lot of people think that older Skywalker who meets Rey will still have his second Obi-Wan looking lightsaber. So this means that he totally doesn't need the one Rey is offering him at the end of Force Awakens, right? Isn't this true? Do we think that this is true? Like, how much of this is going to be playing into it?
Well, I don't think it means that he doesn't need that, because remember, that saber that Rey is handing, that's a family heirloom there. That he's going to need that, because even Kylo Ren's like, that belongs to me.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't. It belongs to Luke. Now, what Luke decides to do with that is another situation here. Now, look, they could play into the fact that it's Obi-Wan's if they wanted to, but that just happens to be the prop that he was using at the time. And Luke could have maybe learned a little bit more from Obi-Wan in a side story somewhere of how to construct a lightsaber or, you know, as a Force ghost, whatever it might be. And he constructed the new one. So what it shows me is that I really, really want any type of novel or comic or anything that explores time between Empire Strikes Back and Jedi. It is the one time period that is so left alone. We have some stories from episode 6 into 7. Mm. We have very rare material from 5 to 6. And I think this is the type of thing that if you're going to throw that in there, you could do. What do you think of this story?
You know, it's ironic is that as somebody who played a lot of Star Wars role-playing games, I remember reading this thing. This is going back years, but I remember reading this thing that they estimate that most game groups, about 80%+ of Star Wars role-playing games with their game masters, they actually play their games in that time period between Empire and Return of the Jedi. However, obviously, we've never seen a lot of big stuff. You know, it's one interesting question too. A lot of people forget that, like, where did Luke get his next lightsaber? Because remember, in that great confrontation on the Death Star, the one that we got behind, he at one point he goes, "Nope," throws his lightsaber away, and then the Death Star blown up. So, I mean, now off camera,
he says, "Nope," and a Death Star blown up.
And so he could have been while dragging Vader. Vader goes, "Hey, don't forget your lightsaber, kid." It's okay, go back
this
get his lightsaber.
Saber is your life.
Yeah, so there could have been that, or he could have just built another one. But I have heard some people saying that. Oh, it's like when Rey finds Luke on Skellig Island, he hadn't had a lightsaber. No, I guarantee you he's got, under that robe, he's got a couple of lightsabers. He's good.
But what, what do you mean?
Family. Yeah, what do you mean? You want a red one? Want a blue one?
Purple?
I've been busy. Remember, though, he also trained a bunch of Jedi before they actually
evolved. Exactly. Yeah. True. And they were all just using sticks. So, I mean, to Christian's point, I mean, but the importance of the lightsaber is not, finally, I have a lightsaber again. It's... No, that is the first. That's the lightsaber Ben handed to me.
My dad's.
Yeah, and it was my father's. Yeah. So all at the same time. So yeah, it's a family thing. Yeah.
I think that if anything, if it goes the way that this story is saying, I think he already has a lightsaber, and it makes it perfect for Rey to now have this as her lightsaber, and they can train together, and they don't have to go build one for her.
Take the green one. The blue one hasn't been too lucky for people.
Do you like your hands? Do you like your hands?
I had one fight with it. Didn't go well.
I'm 0-1.
But I do feel like that clip was just really fun because it's watching Mark Hamill have that moment where he's like, "Oh, it's a replica," and the guy's like, "No, it's not." And he's like, "Oh, crap." Right. Like, I actually used this. I haven't seen this in so long. Yeah. And in the story, which was so interesting, is that, you know, the prop itself was used for both things. It was Obi-Wan's, and then they revamped it so that he could have it. And I don't know if back then they thought, like, this is going to be Obi-Wan's revamped, or it was just like, we already got these props, let's just mix it up and be like, that's a different lightsaber.
Gotta save money.
Yeah, totally. But I loved seeing his reaction to getting to see this because
that
it just shows again that it's, you know, even if you're a part of this world, there's still a reverence and a nostalgia. And when he got to see that prop, I'm sure tons of memories came up that he maybe hadn't thought about in a long time. So that's what I thought was really cool about that story.
I absolutely dug it. I thought it was great. And it makes you remember that these are still, even them who are part of the saga are still fans at heart. Right. And when they touch, even stuff that they've used already, to see it again, there's even more magic to it, you know? And the fact that the collector, Allinger, was telling him the details of that, it was actually what Alec Guinness used. There's that extra level of, like, awe that you see happening there. And one of these theories that came out too is they talked about is that the reason why the blade of the saber is green and not blue is because Luke appropriated an old kyber crystal that was initially used to power Qui-Gon Jinn's lightsaber. So that could be a whole other thing that they add to it, with the assumption that Obi-Wan kept Qui-Gon's lightsaber after he had the fight with Maul. If they start throwing that in and maybe highlight that in Rebels, who knows? So there's a lot of places they can go with this, and I think this was fantastic to watch his reaction.
It makes it interesting because it's like even referencing back to Harry Potter, where it's like there is a rule about how you get your wand, and you can only get a wand from someone else if you've disarmed them and now it's your wand. But with lightsabers, there's no rule like that you have to be the one who got it from this person for you to be able to use it. So it would be interesting if there was something like that, but I don't think they'll add to the mythology in that way.
One of the things we do say in the wand shop when we hand out the wands and give the wands is we say, your wand
using another person's wands is never as effective as using your own wand. So Tiffany's right, right on that. So.
And that could be used in life. Yeah. All right, what's next?
Hello. All right, well, next
one. I wasn't going that way. You guys did.
I was just hoping Ashley Mova was in the room when you said that. That's all.
Are you ready to apologize? Some soundtrack news. This comes to us from our friends at StarWarsNewsNet.com, which obviously we get a lot of the stories from there. The Imperial March apparently can be heard prominently at the end of Darth Vader's last scene in Rogue One. Fans have just discovered that an Easter egg in the soundtrack that cleverly sneaks the opening part of the iconic theme right by us. All right, spoiler alert, although the film's been out for over a month. Yeah. Vader has the Rebels cornered.
If you're watching this show and you haven't seen Rogue One, you're watching the wrong show.
What are you doing? You might notice a few familiar sounding notes thrown into what seems like a completely new composition. And if you play the song at double the tempo, you can hear the portion that coincides with the Darth Vader Imperial March, which is fantastic. Twitter user Bobby Roberts, Roberts PDX, uploaded a short video, and when you watch, like 35 seconds, when you watch it, you're just blown away at how people have enough time to create this stuff and know this stuff. It's just fascinating. Kristian, did you take a look at this, and what'd you think of this?
I watch it. Yeah. Is it clever? Yeah, it's clever. Yeah. Why are you hiding it? Why are you hiding it? Put it in the movie.
Yeah.
It's like, great, I got to find out that later. It's clever. Yeah. He's a great composer. Yeah. Michael Giacchino is a great composer. He's done a lot of good stuff, but it's like, if I need to go faster or slower to figure out, oh, he put it in there. Mm. Put it in there. Mm. Just put it in there. But even that piece of music, here's the thing that people have to realize. I get 80 tweets a day about, have you listened to the score now? You like it a lot better? No, because here's the thing. It's not that I don't think that there's some beautiful music. A lot of the music did fit. And some people go, oh, no, you're wrong. He did use some stuff of the original. I know he did. That's not what I'm saying.
Don't throw a tantrum.
What I'm telling you is that there's certain parts of the movie that when Mendelsohn shows up to Vader's castle, it felt like another sci-fi movie. Mm. It didn't feel like, it didn't feel like Star Wars. There are certain elements that did. There's no argument about it. There's some beautiful music in it throughout it. Yeah. I'm not going to love it because some guy did a podcast about it saying why there were themes in there that worked or why you liked it. It's not going to make me like it. I'm super happy that a lot of you guys did like the actual score. I got somebody guy walking through the studio right now who loved it because but there is a thing that just I didn't respond to it. And this particular thing was clever. Mm-hmm. Whatever.
I feel totally the opposite. I listened to this and I was like, this is so cool.
I'm not saying it's not cool.
Even though I didn't hear it full on, I still got the vibe and the energy of the Imperial March during those scenes. I still felt that. And I don't know if it was just because I was putting it on there or because subtly it's in there and you just have such a connection to it. I don't know. But I thought it was really smart because I feel like there is part of it where he's trying to make this his own, but also still honor the original music and not just have it be like, here's the Imperial March right there for you. So I loved this. I thought it was a really clever way to say, I'm honoring this, but I'm still making it my own and I'm stepping a little bit away from it. So it's not just that.
I don't know why some people, I heard it the first time I saw the movie and I thought yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, right.
I didn't even think it was hidden. I thought, oh yeah, there it is. I'm a little bit surprised. I didn't realize there weren't people who realized it was there. So, yeah, it's fine.
All right.
I liked it. To me, it just shows how inventive some fans can be to spot this. Because I caught at certain moments some, allusions to the original score, to the New Hope, to Vader stuff. But I'm with Kristian. I didn't like the score. It felt rushed. It felt at times out of sync with what you were watching and out of sync with the Star Wars universe. And not because it didn't have enough thing that evoked the original scores. No, it's just that something just felt weird
like
and different
about sci-fi
it. And so eventually, I went back and saw it again, and the score didn't bother me as much.
Right.
So I'm kind of swinging back the other way. But this kind of stuff is always fun. And I love that fans have time to create this stuff. And for me, it's great to watch it and see it. And I thought it was fantastic.
All right. What's next?
All right. Next up. Disney Channel UK shared a new video showing even more alien creatures from Rogue One, some of which you probably see for the first time. Those hosts of Access All Areas, they spoke to one of the Rogue One's creature feature effects supervisors, Neil Scanlon, who revealed what it took to create these numerous alien characters and how he enjoyed every day on set, that, you know, it's always a new challenge and troubleshooting, and you got to see behind the scenes of these actors in the outfits and then the animatronic stuff that they were using, all that stuff, and especially Monkey Man. Monkey Man got profiled as one of my favorite guys. Kristian, did you watch this piece, and how much did you enjoy getting behind the scenes look at these characters?
I did, and I always do. I mean, anytime, especially with Scanlon, it goes back to when we first got excited that they were going to be doing more of this in The Force Awakens.
Yeah.
And now, because of that, and I think that this is, and Rogue One, I think we're going to continue to see this. There'll be a featurette in the Han Solo movie about all the creatures behind. That's what makes Star Wars, Star Wars. You watch these things to go, oh yeah, that's really cool just to see it in the background a little, and then you get little Easter eggs, because remember when that last creature feature thing that they did in Rogue One, someone found the back to tank Anakin in the back there too, and that's how that was revealed. I still think that was an oops, but these things are always fun to watch. Rocha, how'd you feel about
it? Yeah, I loved it. I think it's great to go by. It was only like 2 minutes long. It wasn't that long, and those hosts are great. Great energy, you know, those kids and those young kids, but no, I loved watching the behind the scenes stuff, because it lets you go, this is how much effort they put in just to see some characters in the background, just for a few seconds or one line or something, you know? And that's the kind of love and detail that people who are involved with this property and this franchise give to it every day, you know? And I thought Scanlon did a great job talking about how every day it's something new. And that makes you excited to go to work. And you as a fan go, I know we're in good hands with people like this are in charge of this property, and this, even at the smaller levels, and they're able to bring this stuff to life. I love it.
The creatures and the those environments loaded with creatures, going right back to the first Star Wars movie, is one of the thumbprints of Star Wars. It's one of the identifying markers of Star Wars, much like an opening crawl. I love this. I thought it was really great.
Tiff?
My first thought was, where the heck was this job when I was a kid? I wanted to be doing that. So those kids have an awesome job that they get to do. But I thought it was really cool, kind of like you guys all said, seeing the workings of how they're putting all this stuff together and how excited everybody is to be a part of this. But the part that I found to be really interesting is just talking about how, when they say that it was a practical effect, that there's a person in there, but the face is still being worked by other people. There's still animatronics in the face that they're doing that, where I thought that was so interesting, because from an outside perspective, when I've never worked with doing puppets or creating creatures, obviously. So for me, I'm like, it's a puppet. That means it's just totally controlled by other people. But hearing that there's, you know, so many different levels of what that puppetry or practical effects can be, I thought that was really interesting, because I was actually doing some research the other day on the aliens in Alien and Aliens. Mm-hmm. And they were just saying they had so many different versions of it, whether it was just a straight up puppet that no one was in that they could like form in different ways, or ones that had, you know, just like a leotard, but the lighting was different, so you couldn't tell. So that's the part to me that was really interesting. And I just love hearing about all the different jobs that there are for people who want to get involved in the film industry. There are so many jobs, and this is one of the cool ones.
All right, last one.
All right, last one up. It is about Rogue One and the domestic grossing. It's the highest grossing domestic film of 2016. According to Forbes, Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, earned another
Sorry.
What is that? Oh, my God.
She is like, what is it? Scrooge McDuck?
Let it rain.
Great. Mon Mothma, bitches. All right, earned another $3.24 million on Friday to bring its total to $488 million, which makes it the biggest domestic hit of 2016, which is incredible because that thing came out near the end of December. How amazing. It set the stage for a $12.3 million Friday through Sunday and a $15.35 million Friday through Monday holiday to get itself just close to that $500 million mark on the 32nd day of its release. This will tie it with Avatar, although it's going to end up around $225 million short domestically, but I'm sure, you know, Walt Disney will be fine. But they've said Disney 2016 has been the perfect storm when it comes to these returns. They were the first studio to have an annual domestic revenue of $3 billion this year, and they released all of the top five highest grossing movies of the year in the global market, which is something that probably has never happened. Christian, what do you think about this so quickly?
I think it goes back to, I don't want to beat a dead horse here with the two movies a year thing, but I just think that until that happens, Disney will be in December. They're going to move all their movies. Han Solo is going to go to December. This proves to them this is the ground. They are the first ones on the moon. They were able to really stamp down and make December their own, and Star Wars did it for them. Star Wars is going to be, it's the new May for them, is where it used to be, because Star Wars kind of started the blockbuster season in 77. It really did with the what it was able to do and how long it was in theaters. It was a different time when it opened up in May. It didn't have this type of season that there's so many movies coming out in summer, and now they've kind of evolved and they've taken over this December season. And Rogue One, we all knew that it would do well. To say that it was going to tie or even, you know, or just come short of Avatar domestically, I don't know if we all would have bet on that. I think that that would have been a harder one to do for the first standalone. I think that if we're betting on Episode 8, I think Episode 8, the conversation is going to be, can it beat Episode 7? Which I don't think it will be able to, but I think it will probably beat both Avatar and Rogue One. But Rogue One is in the conversation. Yeah. So that's the big thing. It just speaks on what Star Wars is as a phenomenon.
It's a spin-off movie.
I know.
And it is now the number 7 all-time domestic grossing movie at 500. It's now standing domestically. It stands at $503 million. It's just a sneeze away from $1 billion worldwide at this point. Of course, Star Wars The Force Awakens made $936 million, a record I will contend will probably never be broken.
936 domestically?
$936 million domestically.
Crazy. I don't know if that could be
domestically.
Broken.
The former record holder was Avatar. Yeah. At $760 million,
yeah.
It blew that out of the water. I don't know those are numbers I don't think we're ever going to see again, personally. But for this spinoff movie to be a part of the billion-dollar club, which it is, to be the number 7 all-time domestic movie at over $500 million, honestly, I didn't think it would do this well. I thought it would do very well. I did not think Rogue One would do this well.
Right. Mm-hmm. The only reason that I agree. I don't think that record of Episode 7 will be broken. The only reason Episode 8 now has a chance, I think that look what happened with The Dark Knight.
Mm-hmm.
Dark Knight made a lot of money. It made a lot of money because it was the second movie, obviously, Batman, but it also made a lot of money because of Heath Ledger. This is the last time you're going to see Carrie Fisher on screen.
Yeah.
That might add to a lot of people going to see this. This is the last time you will see Carrie Fisher as Princess Leia. That might have something to do with it. But, John, you hear these numbers. What do you think?
Well, I think it's amazing. And I loved the movie the first time I saw it. Loved it the second time I saw it. I wasn't surprised. I was one of these people on Movie Talk who was constantly saying, like, people are underestimating this film. This film is going to make its money because people are hungry for Star Wars. And it's a different kind of Star Wars take. It doesn't have anything to do necessarily with until near the end with any of the main characters of the original trilogy. So it's giving you all these characters, and they're hitting all these touchstones that we as a society are changing as well. Female leads, Latino leads, these exploration, there's all this stuff that happens, and new worlds, new planets, action, and the ending.
Yeah.
Which people were like, are they going to have the balls to do that? And they did it. And because they did it, I think that makes people come back and watch it even more, because they want to admire something new in Star Wars that isn't necessarily going to hold my hand and make me feel better. This actually goes, no, this is the price that people had to pay for it. And it's almost like a Dirty Dozen type movie, except everyone dies. So that to me is fantastic. I think that's the reason why it has so many, as much legs as it does. And the technical achievement of the film itself. Like, so all of it is just great. And the acting work, just fantastic.
Yeah.
I, like we've all said, I think was surprised about how well it did. I knew it was going to do well. But it was, I went to see it on Christmas with my family because we always do a holiday family film. And for a while, obviously, it was the Lord of the Rings movies and then The Hobbit and then now Star Wars. And when we left the theater, I was talking to my sister, and she likes Star Wars, but she's not like a Star Wars massive fan. And she was like, this was my favorite one ever.
Yeah.
I loved this one. It was so fun. Like, I didn't feel like I had to know anything about the other characters. Mm-hmm. It was just, you were immediately in the story. It was fast paced. So that, when she said that, I was like, oh, this is going to bring in that audience that is a little bit different than the audience that loves, you know, all of the lore, everything that goes along with it, is able to just go in blank slate, watch it, enjoy it, and then forget about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where it's not like you have to go back. You don't have to watch A New Hope to be able to watch this movie and enjoy it.
Yeah.
So I think that was the moment where I was like, wow, they hit on something that I was not thinking about because of the fact that we are such fans. So I think that obviously they're going to keep doing the Christmas season. That's the best time to do it. It's a slow time where people are just trying to find stuff to do with their family. And these are great middle ground where it's like it's a great enough for older people, but still younger people really enjoy it. So obviously, I think they're just going to keep going on and on and on. I don't know that they'll ever beat what The Force Awakens did just because of the tidal wave of excitement there was behind it. But like you said, now with Leia being behind it, and I kind of thought about, which I didn't look at, for Star Trek, where it was Anton passed before that movie came out. And so it was, did people, more people go see it because that was the last time? This is obviously a different situation because it's Princess Leia. But I think that a lot of people will come out because, like, based off of what Laura Dern was saying, how many people don't have some connection to Leia, whether it's boys or girls? And so going to see her in the final performance and what I think will probably, fingers crossed, be her best performance, because she was really excited to be a part of it.
Who, for somebody, tell me, how long of a period of time was there between when Heath Ledger passed away and when The Dark Knight actually came out?
I think it was like a few months.
A few months. See, I know there's a lot of question about how much of a bump will episode 8 get box office wise, because a lot of people want to go out and see Carrie Fisher's last thing. I think that's going to be tempered a little bit by the fact that it was literally one full calendar year.
But I still think it's going to temper it a bit.
I think it's going to temper it a bit. Like, if Star Wars Episode VIII was coming out in, so let's say, 9 weeks from now, I think that one, The Force Awakens record, would be in trouble.
Yeah.
I think it would. But it, the full year, I think it's just going to temper it a little bit.
Possibly.
But you'd be foolish not to think they would at least have some kind of impact.
I was just going to say, I think it's just going to make it easier for people to talk about her on the carpet because it's a longer
time. That's a great point.
Where the fact that it's really so close to it, if it was recent, it's like, it just feels icky and weird. But now, the fact that we are going to have a year, I think it's just going to be a total celebration of her and what she's brought to the Star Wars universe.
I'm sure they're going to do a big tribute to her at Celebration.
No doubt.
All right, now moving on. That's everything in the world of movie news. Now, so we have a shorter topics this time around with our segment that we call What's the Deal with Canon? Everything happening in the world of Star Wars that could be novels, could be games, comic books, TV shows, whatever it is, we're going to talk about it. And I'd also like to, I know that John had, Rocha had mentioned StarWarsNewsNet.com. Not only do they put all these articles together, they write their own special articles. If you're not getting news from StarWarsNewsNet.com, you should really go and check it out. It's like the CNN or MSNBC or Fox, whatever you watch. It is like, I'm trying to be nice to everybody. It is where you want to get your Star Wars news from. All right, Rocha, what's up first and what's the deal with Canon?
All right, we got the preview of the new Star Wars Rebels episode, Trials of Dark Savior.
Dark Saber.
If you've watched this, there's a 30-second preview, there's a minute and a half preview, and you get Fenn Rao talking to us about this Mandalorian Jedi Tar Vizsla, which is insane. And it looks almost reminiscent to like Deathly Hallows when they tell that story. The animation feels, and Excalibur even at times, with the way it's almost like a sword out of the stone. So this is fantastic, because the idea of a Mandalorian Jedi has people going insane on the internet from what I'm reading and seeing. And so if there's a Mandalorian Jedi, there must be a Mandalorian Sith. So it's like this whole thing. So this is a great way to open it up.
Well, Tiffany, John and I have actually seen this episode. And
cool. Thanks. Yeah. Awesome.
But you know what? Hold a second. In our defense, as we're sitting down to watch it, we said, oh, wait a second, we should get a hold of Tiffany. And we said, nah.
Yeah. No, so we called Rocha. And we called John Rocha instead.
All right.
So we are going to on Saturdays, we do our Rebels recap show. And you can check that every time you watch the episode. Then you can watch myself, Ken Napsok, and David Griffin talk about the episode. And you'll be able to do that this Saturday when it comes out. So we're not going to really review the episode because John and Tiffany haven't seen it. But Campea and myself have seen it. Campus, so obviously without giving a full review of it, we can say that what you said to me, and that was that this might be your favorite episode of all time.
Yep. I'm not going to say why. I'm not going to say anything. And please, good folks over there at Disney XD, we are going to hold a review, but I feel safe in just telling you, I think this is the best episode of television this series has ever made.
Wow.
I've never enjoyed an episode more. Not all of you are going to feel the same way, because it struck me in a certain way. I'm just going to say I have never enjoyed, I don't think there's ever been a more important or a better episode of television that this series has ever put
out. That's the one that you hit the nail on the head. And again, not spoiling details of it, Dave Filoni had promised the beginning of this, like he does, whether it's at Star Wars Celebration or get leading into the season, there is going to be some heavy character development, and that Sabine would be the focus of a lot of that. And I would say that this is probably one of those episodes that proves that to be true. But Tiffany, you saw these trailers. What do you think?
I mean, I am just so excited to see more from Sabine. I think even the episode where we saw her with the Mandalorians before and got a little bit more in depth with her, this is just so much. I mean, just the image right there is like, that gets me excited about it. I don't care what happens. I'm like, I'm in. I can't wait to see this episode. I think that they've done a really good job this season where I'm not going to say that some of the more recent ones were a little bit slower, but it felt like it had a lot more breathing room, I guess. So this one, I feel like, and I'm hoping that it is like fast paced. There's a lot of information. We get a lot of good stuff. We get a lot of action. And those shots themselves, I just bought my Sabine Funko that I found online with the helmet. And I'm just so much more excited about it. And I can't wait to possibly be at Celebration and see everybody dressed up as her.
Rocha?
Yeah, this, I'm super excited. I'm a massive fan of the Mandalorian culture. So for me to see this idea of a Jedi, what does it mean? Is there a Sith? What does the Darksaber do? What is the connection? Is Sabine going to take over now? Because I've been saying this for a year and a half now that she needs to be the focus of the show. I love, you know, to me, it's Sabine just is something that she brings. There's a strength and a power and gravitas to her character that I think is so interesting and attractive to watch and fun to watch. And the way the actress voices her over is fantastic too. So this episode looks like, once again, what this season has done really well is expand the universe. Go to these different planets, and they make them interesting. Whereas at times in season two, it was a bit wonky at times, or some of the episodes felt like fillers. I feel like this season, there have been not that many filler episodes, and it's been more about expanding the universe even more, which is what you need to do in season three of a series like this. And so I'm super excited to see what happens.
All right, now the next story is going to be a comic book review, and it's Dr. Aphra number 3. I was just about to get into that comic, and something came up, so I couldn't do it. But Mr. Rocha, have read it. What do you think of this issue? Don't spoil the details.
Yeah, tough. Here's what I'll tell you. You explore more of the father-daughter relationship that's happening with Aphra. They debate whether the Death Star was real or not, which is insane. Yeah. And then they tie some stuff into Rogue One.
Oh,
so
cool.
The timing of this coming out is perfect. Yavin 4 is in this, and it's controlled by the Empire at this point. So they have all that's explored. And then she goes off on this mission, and you get a lot of action involved in this this issue that is so great to do. And coming on the heels of what we got with Poe Dameron last week, I think this is another next issue step the comics are starting to become a little bit stronger and more fleshed out and more interesting. And Aphra is, I mean, slowly becoming to me just below Ahsoka Tano as one of these characters that I want to see in some live action version at some point down the road. She's so interesting. She's the way she plays with Vader is fantastic. I've never seen anyone deal with Vader the way Aphra does, and that's what makes her so fantastic.
I like her, but if I'm going to have my choice of someone that's been in canon and not in, it's going to be Rae Sloan. Rae Sloan to me has to appear first, and then I'll take Aphra. But she's good.
Cad Bane would be pretty good too.
Who's that? Cad Bane.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I will say too, guys, if you're trying to get into the comics, this is a great one to jump in on, because you don't really have to have read all the other ones to jump in. Right. It's a great starting off point to get to know this character, and it feels like Indiana Jones at times. Yeah. And it also, I feel like they're going to reveal a lot of stuff in here that is going to have implications further on, because one of the things she's looking for is an artifact that works with immortality. Mm-hmm. So there is a lot of implications as far as the Sith looking for something like that. I think there's going to be a lot of cool, interesting info that we'll get from reading the comic.
This is what Marvel has done best, is that when you think a story like, whether it's the Star Wars comic or if it's going to be the Vader comic, is going to be where you're going to get the juiciest of the canon knowledge, it isn't. It's stories like this, or in Lando, when the Emperor's ship and stuff of that nature, like that's when you find out a lot of these kind of juicy nuggets. And if you're a Rebels fan, obviously you go back in the Kanan run, which I'm that's the one I'm most upset that it ended, because it was so good. But they're really good at certain. There's certain ones that have missed, whether it's C-3PO or the Leia. Chewbacca, or the Leia run. But they're trying a lot of different things, and by exploring, this is where I think one of our concerns was when you had the universe be too small. Yeah. But what they did was they introduced a character in the Vader run and now gave her a comic that's mm-hmm. working. Mm-hmm. This is what they need to continue to do, not only in comics, with books and in movies and hopefully with shows and all this stuff. So this is a good move.
And they do a smart pull with the touchstone of having essentially an evil version of R2-D2 and C-3PO yeah. and Chewbacca. But mm-hmm. but these characters, instead of being like alternate Seinfeld world, right. this actually works.
And I mean,
it's
come
actually
on.
Fleshed out. You know, and it's fun to follow them on their adventures. And the father-daughter stuff is great.
Well, now it's time to follow you guys on your adventures because you've been tweeting out to us at Collider Jedi Council. We've been going through them and picking them. If you didn't get your question in there, it's all Roka's fault. So what'd you get?
Fair enough. All right, first one comes from @_treatJoeSelf. Hashtag Collider Jedi Council. Would you rather Benicio Del Toro play a dark side user or Luke wrecking shop with a lightsaber in episode 8?
Such a good question.
No, it's not.
Oh, it's such a good question. It's a good question. The reason why it's a good question is because Benicio Del Toro in Sicario and what he did, because what I like to see in my villains, not just I'm bad. It's like there's another layer mm-hmm. to them and why they have the dark side, and that dude can do it. But off of your confused face, the only answer is Luke wrecking shop with a lightsaber. I want to see how good he has become. I want to see how powerful he is. But I also don't think that it is something that he necessarily has to rely on as much anymore. I think that there's more to him, the same way Yoda doesn't have to rely on, minus Attack of the Clones. He doesn't have to. He's able to just lift up an X-Wing, do his thing. And I think that Luke's going to be so powerful at this point. Wrecking shop. All right, we'll go wrecking shop. Go ahead.
I got super confused with this question because I was like, do I want to see Benicio Del Toro as bad or do I want to see him wrecking shop like Luke? And I was like, huh? But now I get it that you said that. Obviously, it's got to be Luke wrecking shop. I'm excited to see what Benicio Del Toro can do, but we didn't get enough in The Force Awakens and I want it bad in the new movie.
You only want to answer this question, huh? All right.
This is like saying, would you like this nickel or 7 chests of sunken Spanish treasure? Like, I would give up sex for 6 months to see Luke wrecking shop.
No, you wouldn't.
Stop it. I would give up sex for 6 months.
Anne, are you watching this?
See Luke pull out that saber and go to town. Are you kidding me?
Everything
I've been waiting 30 years for this.
That whole phrase is so bad.
Pulling out saber and going to town is something all the good.
And piss on a cat. And I will be the odd man out. I have no problem saying this.
No
I would rather see Benicio Del Toro because the Luke wrecking shop is quick. And that'd be fine. We'll talk about it. But if you create a whole new character that's fleshed out, it's fantastic, it's going to carry over to different other episodes of this trilogy, then I want to see that because I'm a massive Benicio Del Toro fan.
What was the moment in Rogue One that you freaked out, though? And it was quick.
When Cassian killed the guy.
You know what? You know what I'm talking about.
Yes, yeah. I know. Yes, but what stays with me is the characters and what they created.
You burn in hell, all right? It's
I
Luke
like
wrecking shot.
Right.
That's the only answer to this.
All right.
Oh, wow.
All right.
Went a way different direction.
All right, our next one is
next.
So next. Yeah.
Jonathan Peck at JPEG 1098 says,
"Hello.
Over or above 50% chance that Snoke takes Kylo Ren to Vader's castle in Episode 8 to finish his training?"
Hey, that's a good question.
That's a good question. I would have gone under if it hadn't been for Pablo Hidalgo's tweet.
Oh
about
yeah.
When they asked him if we're going to see Vader's castle again, he says, it's going to be used down the line. Or maybe it might not have been a tweet. It might actually have been in a Rebels recon. I can't remember. But that doesn't mean that it's going to happen in 8. It could happen in 9. But I'm going to go 51% that he's going to – he's I don't know if Snoke necessarily is going to take him, but I think he's going to go to Vader's castle. How do you feel about it?
Okay. Here's what makes it tricky. After the Empire was defeated – I think they do something. I think the New Republic does something with Vader's castle. Mm. I mean, that's the one little
tricky. Do they know where it is?
I'm going to guess they probably do figure out where it is. But that aside, that big question mark aside, seeing it in the movie, in Rogue One, I'm still curious about that little sniveling worm tongue dude that was serving him there.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to go
52%. Tiffany Smith?
I will say 76% that we're going to see it. Because I feel like they spent the time to create it. they got the reaction from fans that they wanted seeing it in Rogue One. And I think if anything, I mean, it's like we got to see the remnants of the Jedi temples and the Jedi statue down that in Rogue One, that it would be whether the rebels have done anything or there has been some battles there and there's pieces of it that are decrepit and falling apart. Seeing Kylo Ren walk into that space, like, I get the chills thinking about it. Right. I think it just visually,
and when he pulls up to
so
the castle
stunning.
And go, burr, burr, burr.
Maybe it'll be slowed down so that way when you speed it up, burr, you'll hear it.
Don't. What do you got?
Don't choke. I was with Tiffany. I was at 70. So I'm in Tiffany's camp. Because, A, I don't think Leia or Luke would let them destroy the castle because it is still their father and their father's been redeemed. And so to me, I don't think they'd approve even the bad side of him because there's something about the archaeology aspect of it. And Luke was going.
Well, he burned his costume.
Well, Luke was going in all those different places to find those old artifacts, right? So there's a respect for these kind of older things. And I think, I mean, the castle might be decayed, but I don't think they'd necessarily send to people and waste the resources to destroy it.
I agree with that because I don't think the rebels would be like, this is so bad, we've got to destroy it. They'd leave it and be like, okay, nobody go there.
Right.
I don't think they know where it is.
Anyway, what's next?
All right, Tim DeGrand, at Tim DeGrand asks, will you be as disappointed as me if we don't see a certain hut in the Han Solo movie? And please, not special edition CGI.
No, absolutely. Zero's got to be there. You gotta have. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, Zero the Hutt? Right. No, listen.
Zero!
I think that. Would I be disappointed? Yeah, but you gotta remember that when he's in it, if he's gonna be in it, he's not fighting with Han. Yeah. He's working with Han. Mm-hmm. Like at this point in the story, he's working with him. So I think it would be cool if there was a nice cameo in there. He comes in, Han takes some kind of job from him or. Do I think it's necessary? It's not necessary to have him in it. How do you feel about it?
Yeah, I think it'd be nice to have him in it. I think it'd be fun. And I have no doubts that he'll be in it in some form. I would like it to not be CGI. I agree with that. There's too much of residual PTSD from seeing that in the special editions. But I'd love to see Jabba because people love Jabba for a reason. There's something about him that's super interesting. So you want to see him in different forms, different versions, different times in his life. And it's always fun when the Hutt show up in any of the media. So it's fun.
John.
Speaking of Zero the Hutt, that just took me back to that thing of watching that Clone Wars movie and thinking, my God, this movie can't get any worse. And then Zero the Hutt showed up.
Oh, yeah, Zero was pretty awful.
But I think it would be sad and pathetic.
If he shows up?
Yeah.
And even in a scene?
The reason being is because Star Wars has not done well. Rogue One was an exception. But generally speaking, Star Wars has not done well, especially in the prequel era, of saying, look, here's somebody else you recognize. And look, we already got Han, Chewie, we got Lando.
But it could fit the story, though.
Yeah. It could, but look, it's such a big universe. Yeah. It's such a big universe. I would rather than not, but I mean, who knows? If they do it and they do it well, could be great. Mm. My just initial feeling is I'd rather them not do
it. I do agree with the viewer, though. No CGI job. If you're going to do it, go full puppet or go home.
Yeah. Definitely no CGI, full puppet for sure, if it's in there. I wouldn't be disappointed if Jabba's not in it. I only want to see it if it's integral to the story.
Yeah, I agree.
I don't want to see like Jabba in the background.
Yeah.
If
he's a core part of the story that sets everything in motion, I'm cool with that. Just another, oh, look, there's Jabba in the background.
Yeah. I feel like Jabba's too big of a character to just do like, there he is, bye.
Literally.
Yeah. Remember, Han's on Tatooine when we first see him, so he does a lot of dealings with Jabba because Jabba's on that planet. So he's.
Which makes you wonder, why was he there if you knew Jabba was after him?
Well, he's probably on his way out. I mean, it's probably, it's one of those
hanging
things.
Hanging out in a cantina, knowing that Jabba's out.
But he was, though, because even,
remember, in the scene that was cut out or put back in, Jabba confronts him. And he's still like, all right, I just wanted to let you know that I'm going to send somebody off. Well, I don't know why you needed to kill Greedo, but I'm still, I'll give you another shot, but I can't have you just doing that type of thing. So I'm just letting you know that next time. They had that kind of relationship, and that's the special edition scene itself showed a different dynamic. I hated the fact that they show him
stepping over
his tail, and he's stepping on his tail.
Look,
and
we make Han go up as if he stepped on him.
Yeah. Anyway, all right, let's do one more.
Okay. This is from Salim Frazier. Does the Journals of Kenobi comics take place after the Maul encounter in Rebels?
It's a good question. Now, if you're talking about when the timeline happens when Luke finds them, then yes, it takes place after the Battle of Maul and Obi-Wan on Tatooine, because that takes place after Episode 4.
Technically, we don't know that they battle.
Well, true. The confrontation or their meeting. Correct. But the actual journals span a bunch of different things. I mean, even in the last one, Obi-Wan was writing about Yoda. Never said his name, but was writing about Yoda. So it spans different parts of time. There's one part of the journal that covers when Luke is 5. So that would be before that encounter. So it just depends. If that's what you're asking, the first part of it, when he finds it, then it's after. If it's any of the actual stories, I mean, does anybody else have anything else?
Yeah, if he finds it, then it's after. That's what I agree. I agree with
All right, then I guess we can do one more.
Okay. Fine. This is from Darth Kragus at Kragus07. Mm. Do the general populace know Luke and Leia are twins and Anakin is their father? Did it become known Vader was Anakin?
That could be answered in Bloodline.
Right.
I don't know the answer to the general populace know Luke and Leia are twins now.
Right.
Because I don't know whether the Laura Derns of the world or made it public knowledge afterwards. I know that there's a bit during Bloodline. It comes out now, and I think that I would assume that most people do. I mean, all the government knows about it, and some people question Luke in that novel. And I remember one of the senators actually stood up for him and said how much of a hero he was, and to back off of that right away. As far as Anakin being Vader, I don't know if that was ever. No, and I assume so. It's the same thing. Yeah. If it's a matter of if that's your dad, who was her dad? Oh, her dad was Anakin Skywalker, I would assume. Do you see it any differently?
Well, I mean, in Bloodline, it made it very clear that, it was broadcast across the HoloNet. Like, everybody knew that. Because in Bloodline, this isn't giving away a clear plot point, but in Bloodline, at one point, Princess Leia is running to be the next Supreme Chancellor.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And she was the front runner, and it was pretty much a shoo-in she was going to win, and then it got leaked that she was the daughter of Darth Vader. Mm-hmm. And so, the general population knows that. The Anakin part,
To assume, though.
It's
like, how's Darth Vader a father?
But remember,
I guess he was a Skywalker. Do we know any Skywalkers? Yeah, Anakin.
Remember, the assumption in the universe is that Anakin Skywalker died a long time ago, that he died during when the Empire was born, that Anakin died in the Jedi Purge. Not everybody knew. We learn in Tarkin that even Tarkin didn't know.
Kind of
like,
thought
Tarkin
it, right?
had suspicions, but somebody like General Grand Moff Tarkin, even he didn't really know. So does the fact that she is the daughter of Vader make it public knowledge that, Darth Vader was actually Anakin? I don't think there's been anything in canon to suggest one way or the other at this point.
Yeah.
I mean, like you said, in Bloodline, obviously there's stuff that's out to the public. Mm-hmm. I don't think that it's 100% known that everyone thinks, Anakin is Darth Vader. Because I think that would have, someone would have said it. It would have come out even in Bloodline. Something, someone would have mentioned it.
Well, Snoke knows. Obviously, so Snoke knows because he knows, like, the lineage of Kylo.
Yeah.
Right.
So there's, some people know. We know that at least.
Yeah, it's a good question. So, all questions that we may or may not find out in Episode 8, 9, or some other novels. But we're going to be reading everything because there's so much new stuff. That's one of the things I can't wait for Celebration, the new novels that are going to be announced. And obviously, we have Empire's End that's coming up pretty soon here. We've got Thrawn that's coming up in April. A lot of good stuff to be reading and checking out. But that's it. Thank you guys for checking out this show. This is Collider Jedi Council. I'd like to thank the council that joined me today, starting out with the Smith Lord, Miss Tiffany Smith. Where can they find you?
You guys can find me on social media at Tiffany's Tweets, and you can find me on DC All Access all week. Same thing on the DC YouTube page.
Obi-John Kenobi, where can I find you?
You guys can follow me on Facebook and on Twitter, simply at John Campea, and of course, Monday through Friday on Movie Talk.
Rocha Fett, John Rocha, the Outlaw, where can I find you?
Guys, you can always find me at The Rocha Says, there on Twitter and Instagram, see all the shows I'm hosting and co-hosting, and of course, Fridays on Movie Talk here on Collider.
And make sure you check out the Movie Trivia Schmodown. If you're not watching it, you should check it out. We have our season premiere. It's going down tomorrow. Oof. Two big matches. You've got Superhero News, Hector Navarro and Adam Havilak versus John Campea himself, filling in for John Schnepp and Robert Meyer Burnett. And then, Little List of Evils, Mr. JTE, part of the reigning team champion. Sorry, Rocha. Going up against the beast, William Bibbiani. Go and check that out. That's on the channel tomorrow, 2 p.m. For us, thank you guys for watching. May the Force be with you, always.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.